Once again, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and children of all ages, you are now tuned in to the Prince of Investing, coming to you guys and girls live all the way from the beautiful state of Denver, Colorado, via the beautiful state of Honolulu, Hawaii. Man, I wish I could be in Hawaii right now. But anyway, thank you guys and girls for tuning in. Don't forget to hit that like, subscribe, comment, share button. Check out the description box to support all of the efforts that we're doing here in ThinkTech. But as always, I don't have a lot of time, and I definitely, you guys and girls don't have a lot of time, so we're going to jump straight into it. Today's episode, we're going to talk about fundamental analysis versus technical analysis. Now, I know some people always say, okay, well, that's kind of a vague topic, could be a little difficult or whatever, but I'm going to break it down and tell you why it's important, how it applies to me, how it applies to you. So when I very first got into the world of investing, everybody always thinks of technical analysis. I was like, man, I'm not too smart. You know, investing is too hard, you know, because you got to know when to get in, when to get out. You got to know, you know, what's the right chart? What is this? Whatever the case may be or whatever. What I didn't realize is that what I was thinking about was technical analysis. I wasn't thinking about fundamental analysis. Prince, what is it? What's the difference? So first, we're going to talk about what is fundamental analysis. Then we're going to talk about what is technical analysis. Then we're going to talk about how they are the same, how they could be used, who uses them the most, and how they could benefit you. With knowing this knowledge, this will help you and direct you with becoming a better investor because it helps you know where you stand, right? So first, fundamental analysis. Fundamental analysis, when it comes down to the world of investing and finance and things like that, those are things that are very fundamental, like income statements. If I let somebody borrow money, how much money do they make? How much money do they spend? How much money does it cost to operate the business? How much debt is the business in? Those are the things that are fundamental, very fundamental things, things that you want to know about a company. If you was going to go invest into a company, simple things you want to know, what is the brand? Is it a good brand? Is it a strong brand? Does it make money? Is it a profitable company? Is it a non-profitable company? How much money does it make? How much money does it spend? What is the network? Those are very fundamental things that people use. So when you look at this, the people that use these things are usually your long-term investors, long-term people. For prime example, my most recent purchase stock. Two of my most recent purchase stock. I've been a long-time investor, not a long time, few years investor into McDonald's, right? It was Wesley's sixth birthday, and for his birthday, I brought him a couple shares of McDonald's, right? Years have gone by and the shares have done pretty well thus far. It done so well that I always wanted to buy more shares. And when I wanted to go buy more shares, the stock kept going up and it's not a good time to buy when the stock is going up. If you pay attention to the news as of lately, the CEO was fired from McDonald's. The CEO was fired for sexual misconduct, for sexual conduct with an employee, right? When I immediately saw this, I said, CEO getting fired for sexual misconduct. Fundamentally, has anything happened to the fundamentals of the company? I.e., I'm investing into a company not because of the CEO, I'm looking at the money. Finances, has anything happened to finances? Has anything happened to the income of the company, the network of the company? And the answer was no. The only thing that it could possibly mess with was the management. But I'm in the strong belief that McDonald's is much like Coca-Cola, meaning that a ham sandwich can run McDonald's. If I was the CEO of McDonald's tomorrow, it's kind of hard to mess up the brand of McDonald's at this point. It's a pretty well-oiled machine. Everybody know what it is. It's the strongest fast food brand. Everybody copies it. Yes, people say it's unhealthy or whatever the case may be, but we all know all the kids love it, and there are new kids being born every day, so it's pretty hard to run. I'm pretty sure the CEO will step down, like he's already done, and a new CEO will step in, and McDonald's will do just fine. So the stock dropped 3% just from the CEO getting fired. When that happened, I saw that as a golden opportunity to go in and purchase additional shares of McDonald's because I knew by the time Thanksgiving rolled around, by the end of next week, we'll forget all about the McDonald's CEO. We wasn't thinking about him before. We won't be thinking about him in the future. So I knew that wouldn't be a great deal blow to the company. So I use fundamental analysis to say nothing happened to the company fundamentally. The stock dropped just due to public relations, right? Anytime you have a big blowback like that, nothing fundamentally happened to the company. I was able to go in and purchase additional shares. Within the next day or two, the company went right back. It was at, I want to say, $190. Then it dropped down to $107. I brought shares. It went back up to $190-something, whatnot, making that position profitable within a day, right? So that was, I utilized fundamental analysis. I just looked at the fundamentals of the company, and I said nothing has fundamental to the company. And I was able to make an investment just using fundamental analysis. Now, let's go into this technical analysis. Technical analysis is the stuff that we see in the movies, right? What I mean by that is on Wall Street, you know, I've been on trading floors, and the trading floor just monitors all over the place. Numbers are jumping up all over the place. Charts are here, charts are there. People are drawing all across the charts. They're drawing X's and O's and dots and I's. They have the candlesticks. They have the mountain charts. They have all these type of things. You know, they're looking at moving averages, the 20-day moving average, the 200-day moving average, crossing over each other. This is all this technical stuff. They're doing technical analysis to see where the stock will head to next, right? You know, people can, I know great friends of mine who are day traders, right? And you know, go back to it, technical analysis is very popular in the day trading space. There are people who pop up the monitors, who watch the monitors, they watch where the stock is trading, they watch the volume, they watch things like volume, moving averages on top of numbers and all sort of good stuff like this. You know, you look at the curves, the pie charts, this curve hit that curve, all this other great knowledge is out there where people, they're trying to make a prediction of where will this stock head next. Those are usually short-term day trading investors, short-term people. They don't care about how much money and finances of McDonald's or whatnot. They're looking at, hey, look, steep sell-off, I think it's going to bounce back here. Boom, I'm going to short it. I'm going to bet against it. Boom, I'm going to bet with it. And they make their money in between. That is technical analysis, right? And that is usually, when we look at the world of investing, the most popular thing. It's the first thing we see when we see Wall Street. Technical analysis. We see people do all these things technically, and we start to wonder, oh my God, I can't do that, or whatever. Not realizing that there are two sides to it. If you're going to be the long-term person, you're going to be the long-term investor, aka the Warren Buffets of the world, you're going to be somebody who's looking at a lot of fundamentals of the company. Is this a good company? How much money has it made? How much money has it lost? All of the good things. Here's another example. Just earlier this week, you had Under Armour. Under Armour dropped 50, I know they dropped about 10%, if I'm not mistaken. It dropped somewhere between 5 to 10% in a day due to them following up on an investigation because of accounting practices, right? So me as a fundamental person, I said, well, accounting practices, that means that they could have been reporting bad numbers. That says that, hey, investors are investing off of numbers. Maybe they've been reporting bad numbers. That automatically strikes fear, right? Because that's going against my fundamental analysis. I didn't look at Under Armour as a buying opportunity because of the fundamentals was in question. McDonald's, I made a investment into them because I used my fundamental analysis, and it was favorable to me. I said, hey, nothing has happened fundamentally. This stock just dropped just because of public relation. They'll forget about this, and it'll bounce back up. So I made a position on McDonald's. Under Armour, they fell up on a scrutiny because of bad accounting practices. When I saw that, whoa, bad juju, that goes against my fundamentals. I can't make a judgment on fundamental analysis. I didn't jump on it. But both of the companies rebounded. But I felt more comfortable with a McDonald's. That's a fundamental person. When we're going back to switch gears to a technical person, they're looking at, oh, massive sell-off for the day. They may look at the news of why it sold off, but they're making trades for today, maybe for the week or for the month. They're more short-term investors, right? There's someone, I know one guy who trades Apple every single day, and he's been trading Apple stock for the last 200 years, and he knows Apple like the back of his hand. and he turns it on. He looks at charts. He knows what Apple is going to do. He watches volume. He uses candlesticks. He watches the bulls and the bear when they're going to come in. He uses the 10-day moving average with the 20-day moving average, all these amazing charts, things like that to make his adjustment. Those are technical people. Okay, Prince, you told me what fundamental was. You told me what technical was. You told me the type of two people that use it, how it could be beneficial to you. So what? The so what purpose is, this is what scares people away from the world of investing. When I saw the world of investing, the first thing I looked at, I evaluated the technical analysis. I said, whoa, you got to be like a genius to understand investing because you have this and that and, you know, all these type of formulas and blah, 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 whatever the case may be. I got to have charts and I got to have four or five monitors that sit in front of me and I got to know when to buy and when to sell and when to do this, when to do that, when to do that. That's what I thought the world of investing was. And that's what kept me away from it as a young man. I said, man, you know, I stayed away from the world of investing because I thought, man, this might be too difficult. So, but then as I got older and as I educated myself and learned from different investors and formal and informal education, I started to stockpile my library. I realized, wow, there's a difference between technical analysis and fundamental analysis. And I'm more of a fundamental person. In the beginning, I didn't know who I was. I started off in the beginning, you know, I was doing Forex, I was doing penny stocks, I was doing some of everything. Just wanted to get my hands in everything. I was buying all the technical analysis books to see when a stock would drop, when it would return, when it would do this, how to read charts, moving patterns, you know, all of the good stuff like that, you know. And then when I started, I thought that was part of investing. But now I'm able to differentiate between the two. Wow, this is technical. This is fundamental. You're a fundamental person, you may love a Warren Buffett. If you're a technical person, you may love one of our popular day traders I know personally, Mr. Alan Velez, right? He may be a big person in the day trading world. There's numerous big day traders that are out there, but those are two people. So when you're going into the world, you have to figure out, I learned fast. It was a time when I was younger, I just wanted to make it on my own. Then as time came, I wanted to be successful, but something I still struggle with today. When I say, man, I want to be successful, I don't know the roadmap a lot of times. But when you know what you want to be, if my son came to me and said, Dad, I want to be a police officer, you know exactly the path it takes to be a police officer. But if my son says, Dad, I want to be successful, it's a wide array. So coming into the investing world, when you know exactly, hey, I'm trying to make money. I'm a make money person. So you may utilize technical analysis and you may just see, you may go down a direction of finding more things that make you technical, right? Versus if you're somebody, hey, I have a nice job, a nice career, whatever. I'm looking to grow my money. How can I grow my money? When you look to grow money, what does that do? That's somebody who's looking at the fundamentals, who's a long-term person, right? So the thing is, knowing if you are someone who's looking to grow money versus someone who is looking to make money, you can differentiate between I'm a fundamental person, or I'm a technical person. Once you know that I'm looking to grow money, I'm a fundamental person, now you can learn to study financial sheets. You can learn to study companies when they're good and when they're bad, because I like to find good companies that's having a bad time. Great companies that are having a bad time. That's what I like to find, right? That's why I think McDonald's is a great company, had a bad time. I like to jump in, right? So it's the same thing with if you're a technical person, hey, I want to do this as a living. I want to do this as a job. I want to sit back. I want to day trade. If you want to day trade, then you're someone who may go out and you may say, hey, I want to study people like maybe Oliver Velez, people who have pattern charts, who know how to make charts and who know how to read charts, because I'm looking to invest for today, tomorrow, evaluate volume, because I'm looking to make money. So now you can go down the technical analysis field. The thing is, you don't want to end up with both, like me, right? I ended up grabbing some technical stuff and grabbing some fundamental stuff, and I thought I had all of this stuff, right? But if you know where you're going, you'll get there a whole lot faster. When you know, like, hey, I'm a fundamental investor. I'm a person who likes to invest into fast food restaurants. Once you know who you are, you can become great at it. It's just that when you don't know where you're going, just that person who goes to college just to be successful, they may end up wasting a lot of time versus the person who goes to college and know exactly, I want to be a doctor, their chance of success is 10 times better, right? Hopefully that makes sense to you guys and girls out there today. Hopefully that makes you a better investor. Hopefully now that you know the difference between the two. Some people don't even know it's a difference. There is a difference between the two. You know it's a difference. You know that fundamental usually a long-term person looking to grow money. Technical person is usually a short-term person who's looking to make money, right? So you know which one you want to do. If you want to be the master of them all, go ahead, right? But if you want to say, hey, I want to choose a path and I want to become the best technical chart reading pattern person in the world, go ahead. If you say, hey, I want to be the fundamental person, I want to be the best fundamental person in the world, go ahead. But over time, it's shown that the fundamental long-term person is usually the bigger winners when it comes down to the world of investing. I'm not saying that, you know, yes, somebody may make $10 billion, but if you end up making $2 billion, that's not bad either. Whatever it is, be great at it. So hopefully that makes a lot of sense. Hopefully that helped you. Don't forget to hit that like, subscribe, comment, share button. Drop us a comment below if you got comments. Drop us an email below if you want to shoot an email. Until the next video, podcast, book, cartoon, or whatever else crazy you see us do around the globe, whatever you decide to do, be great at it. Peace, be safe, I'm out, and thank you.